Hello, everybody out there in internet world. I'm your MC, Katajun. This is Dwelling of Duels, and I am joined by none other than Tony Dickinson
himself. Hello, hello! Oh my God. It's good to be here.
Welcome, welcome. Thank you for blessing us with your presence. And thanks to everybody out there who's joining us on Twitch. We're going to have a lot of fun here. We got Tony, you are the number one gold medal holder for DoD ever.
Yes, I guess so. That is my contribution to the world.
You have 29 golds, two silver, and three bronze. Mm-hmm. You only have 49 entries.
Oh, wait, hold on. Saying no audio from Austin right now.
Oh, shoot.
Let's see. Let me just...
What?
I think I'm just way louder than you.
Oh.
I think I'm just way louder than you, Austin.
I wonder if that's better. Can everybody hear me now?
Better, but you are a little distorted.
God damn it. Check. Now I can see myself. Bear with us, everybody. Audio filters. Gain.
We are audio engineers. We are musicians.
Turn it up. Make it louder.
We can make it happen.
Okay, am I clipping for you, Tony, now?
No, you're not.
Okay,
super good.
Now I just gotta get it balanced inside of OBS. Thanks, everybody in the chat, for keeping an eye out on us. Check, 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 check. Okay, it looks like the levels are more balanced now. Can you talk some, Tony?
Hello, hello.
I think you're still a teensy bit louder than me, but it looks like we're good. So I will reiterate my intro. 29 gold medals, Prince of Darkness, 2 silver, 3 bronze. Those don't count for anything. They're basically gold. Anyways, I was going to say you haven't gotten less than a silver since 2013, but as of Metroid Month, that's not true, unfortunately.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for hopping in. So while I continue fiddling with my audio settings, you are a full-time professional musician, right? Can you tell us a bit about, I just want to know, how did you first get into like recording yourself at home? You know, a lot of people out there have played musical instruments their whole life and things like that, but it's the jump from being like just playing your instrument to learning how to record yourself and produce is pretty instrumental to being like, you know, a well-rounded musician. What was it like for you to get started with that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I totally agree. Recording, you know, has been massively instrumental, pun intended, and me developing into the musician that I am now. My first recording story, let's see. 8th grade, I'm 14, and I think I had like a Digitech effects processor, and I had a cable with one of those like 1/4 inch to 1/8 inch converters that went straight into the mic jack on the back of the computer. And I think the first thing I tried to record, I was playing bass in a community play version of Footloose, which I think I could actually credit the part where I partly get some of my like 80s pop, 80s rock taste from is the Footloose soundtrack actually has some pretty sweet songs on it. But there was a Kenny Loggins song, not the Footloose theme, but it was like there's like another Kenny Loggins song in Footloose that I tried to record into Cool Edit Pro, I think was my first DAW. Cool Edit Pro, before it became Adobe Audition, had a lot of bugs. And so I recorded, you know, it's direct tone, of course. Guitars and bass, and I think it was like a sound font drum set. that I found somewhere and processed it. But yeah, that was the very first thing I tried to record. And then after I kind of got used to that, I was like, oh, this is kind of cool. And then I think when I was a freshman in high school, I definitely recorded like 14 or 15 Megadeth covers. They are way worse than you can imagine. After Cool Edit Pro, then I tried Magix. I don't know if maybe some people have used Magix. And then after I got hooked up with, or I started talking to Snapple Man, was like the first guy in DOD that I started talking to. He suggested Cubase, and then I started using Cubase, and I've been a lifer ever since.
Forever using Cubase.
So yeah, yep, Cubase lifer, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Is it? What do you? It's interesting how like the I know from talking to all of to you and Snappleman and Norg, the three of you are all pretty much Cubase people, but it seems really interesting to see like how of course the tools that you use are going to change over time. You go from Cool Edit Pro to Magix to Cubase and stuff like that, and now like Reaper has become really, really popular. Mm-hmm. People are still out there using Cubase and things like that, but it's really interesting to see like the evolution of the tools that people are using. Even in that kind of case, with those like early covers that you were playing, were you doing all the instruments? Like you were doing bass and then guitar and then clicking into drums.
It was bass and guitar, yeah, and then like sound fonts mostly for like keys and drums.
Yeah.
But I've been playing bass and guitar roughly about the same amount of time. It's just bass where I've been involved in more like different kinds of ensembles, like jazz band and like gospel church band and like marching band and stuff like that. So having experience with more styles, I feel more like bass is really my primary that way. Cause I feel like I have more range on bass.
That's awesome. And I mean, if anyone out there doesn't know, Tony is an extremely talented multi-instrumentalist, producer, etc., plays bass for the Trans-Siberian Orchestra for their touring East Coast band every year. For how many years have you been a part of that?
This upcoming season will be my fifth touring season, but I was involved with TSO as far back as 2011, so it's been a while.
Awesome.
But my first touring season was 2017.
Yeah. And if you ever get a chance, people out there, to go see the East Coast band specifically, it's a rocking show. I mean, the West Coast band, I'm sure, is great too, but
yeah.
I go see if anybody out there in the chat has any questions for us while we're going through, go ahead and pop them in there. We'll try it. We're keeping an eye on the chat and we'll get them over here and answer them if appropriate, of course. So Tony, what, when you started doing DOD, I mean, you know, you came in with a ridiculously talented set of covers just to begin with, like your Mega Man X covers and things like that. Fantastic stuff. And you've been kind of growing as a musician, I'm sure, alongside DOD as you were making covers and things like that. Is there any kind of skills that you got from DOD that, like, translated very nicely to other musical avenues, whether it was playing or production or something like that?
Honestly, I feel like I can credit doing like remixes and music production to pretty much every other avenue of how I've developed as a musician. Like when I really liked doing remixes because well, first of all, I'm a perfectionist. That should be news to nobody. But I liked doing remixes because it was, you know, it's someone else's material, right? It's another composer's writing. And so I can kind of like separate the ego from that a little bit and not worry so much because, you know, I can stress for forever trying to get like the right melody. But if I'm kind of working with somebody else's writing, it made me kind of think about, made me focus more on all the other aspects of constructing a song, you know, like harmony and arrangement and production. And when I started doing DOD, like the first, you know, like the first song I did was obviously like a metal song, and I have, you know, pretty thick metal roots, but I've also always been, you know, in, like, interested in and have played, like, you know, like jazz and funk and stuff like that. So when my second track, like the Hot Pink of Blues from Final Fantasy VI, was, and it was a basically like a kind of like a jazz track, it kind of has like a little heavy section later on, but I kind of discovered by doing the remixes and doing DOD that I could kind of experiment with different styles, and DOD kind of gave me some structure. It's I find it hard to just like make music for the sake of music, where if I have like a purpose to make that music, it's easier for me to finish it. So that's why I've always kind of left DOD. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Like there's a hard deadline. You got to get it done. Mm-hmm. And like the themes, like, you know, a little bit of limitation is always kind of nice and can spur some creativity. But I've never really been an exercise player. So like, you know, just like practicing my scales or my arpeggios every day or whatever, you know. I've always been a learn the song kind of player. Even if it means like I have to open up Guitar Pro, write it in, slow it down, and just do it that way. And that's mostly how I've built up my chops, is, you know, like Dream Theater, Symphony X songs, or something that I write for myself that I just have to learn how to play. And so then I just have to slow it down, do it slow, you know, and build it up slowly. And that's how I got most of my chops, I think. So, you know, like, and I've wanted to be, you know, like a professional musician ever since I started, you know, holding the bass, ever since I started playing the thing. I was like, wow, this is awesome. I love it. This is what I want to do. And like every time I do like a new DOD track or whatever, a Tiberian Sun's track or a Silva track or a Soto track or whatever, I always try to make it better than the last one I did, even if it's just marginal. So like, you know, like it's hard to sustain that, you know. It's kind of hard to sustain
that. You can only go so high.
Right. But making sure that I'm, you know, kind of like that I'm happy with what I put out, I like it, and doing it over and over and over again, you get faster at it. And so taking those skills that I've learned from, you know, at least like the first 4 or 5 years of doing DOD tracks, I brought over into when I started doing like trailer and library music, because a lot of that stuff definitely translates over, especially the orchestral stuff. And I've always been into the orchestral stuff, and trailers have orchestras and a lot of stuff. But so learning how to do that stuff, like I could easily tell anybody, like I cut my teeth in music by doing DOD. And like, even though I'm doing like all these other things professionally, I still come back to DOD because, I mean, a lot, you know, a lot of my friends are here, and that's one of the most important things. But also it just gives me inspiration and different ideas to maybe try something new. And, you know, obviously I do like the Tiberian Sons thing repeatedly. And that's not really anything new stylistically for me, but I still like to do, you know, some like some of the Sonic stuff where it's like, you know, fun, like the Sonic Mania track I did a couple years ago, or the Samba track, or the Kirby track that I did with John Stacy.
Just Tiberian Sun stuff, you still bring in like new sounds to it, like the one that you did with Valnuccio. I can't remember if that was recently or not, because I know it was on the Tiberian Sun's album, but I don't remember when the submission was for DOD.
So that was April 2011. And
2011. Yeah.
No, I'm sorry. 2021.
It feels like that long ago.
yeah, 2021. So yeah, so that has actually kind of been like a thing with the Tiberian Sons, is really kind of starting with that song. Whereas like before, so that was the Ace Combat 7 track. And before that point, Tiberian Sons was really kind of like an evil last boss cover band, basically. Like we do like One Winged Angel and Dancing Mad and like Hell March, and just like they all kind of have like all those songs kind of have just like this you know, yeah, really menacing flavor. And then when Max suggested or he showed me Daredevil the first time, it was before I didn't even play it. I was just floored. I was like, of course, I've played the Ace Combat song, Ace Combat games before, but I hadn't played Ace Combat 7. And he showed me that song. I was like, oh my God, this is an insane piece of music. And, but it was like, I mean, in my opinion, like the original Daredevil that Keiki Kobayashi, I'm gonna butcher all the pronunciations. It's like a perfect song to me. It's like perfectly constructed. So, If I was going to cover it, I want, you know, like, and I want to put something new into it. I blended it with a different Ace Combat track instead, a song called Magic Spear, which is just like this great jam, funky, good groove. But it happened to be in like the same key and roughly the same tempo. It was about like 10 beats faster, I think, than Daredevil. So I started working on that, and I played the game, and I just loved the game. And the moment where Daredevil comes in is like a big like Ace Combat moment. If you play the Ace Combat games, you know they can be kind of dramatic, but they make you feel real good. So yeah, like I loved it, and I just wanted to make that song as good as it possibly could because I love the song and I love the game. And when that happened, it was like, wow, well, this is kind of like a different flavor than the Tiberian Sons have done in the past. So since then, our sound has kind of spread out a little bit. And like we've been doing like Paper Mario, and like we plan on doing more Paper Mario, more Ace Combat. But nice. we're looking in like other directions and other flavors that we can use to arrange and add to our repertoire.
It was inevitable that you know, after doing like DoD stuff for so long, that just like your own personal style kind of like evolves and you find different like experimental things to do, that I think Tiberian Sons was next up on the docket. And I think that you know, you're certainly you have your style locked down with the Tony Dickinson, the main Tiberian Sons style, but I think it's awesome when anybody, you or anybody else out there who enters DoD, does something that's like totally left field, kind of instrumental, different instruments, different genres altogether. I just find those kind of things so amazing. And yeah, definitely one of the best things that people end up doing, because all those new things you learn by exploring different genres, right?
Totally, totally, man. I encourage that with even like guitar students. Where I think it's almost like the best perspective you can get about like a genre of music or an instrument or anything like that is by standing outside of it, you know?
Yeah.
So you can learn having an outside perspective on what that thing is. You can only get it when you're on the outside, you know? So like being able to have a wide range, I think, gives you a clearer image of what a genre means, or you know, or what the purpose of an instrument is, or how it tends to be played, you know, stuff like that.
Definitely, totally agree. We have a question from Prozax in the chat.
We got a couple questions. I'm copying and pasting them down.
Prozax asks, what's your day-to-day like when creating music?
So I can really speak mostly for the past couple of years. Definitely the quarantine, I think, is where I kind of got things kind of locked into habit, where it's mostly waking up about 7 a.m. because my wife has to go to school, and my dogs will not let me go back to sleep. And I start between 8 and 9, and then I just work straight until about 6 p.m. I'll probably have like a gym break in the middle somewhere, like break my day in half. But I just work solid through from like 9 to 6 on most weekdays. When I am not like when I'm up against a deadline for like delivering a project, it'll mostly be that work. If the deadline's kind of far off, you know, like I'll probably start the day off by like practicing, you know, practicing some bass, practicing some guitar, maybe watch like a I don't know, mixing masterclass or something. I have a few of those. And I like doing a variety of different things in the day. If I have a choice, then I like to do like a variety of things. Like I don't like doing a project for more than like 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
It actually drains me. But of course, when you're up against a deadline, you just have to do it, and you just have to push through it. But yeah, I will try to divide my time up. Or it's like practicing in the beginning, and then I'll have like two or three songs that I just work on, and then I'll work on those two or three songs each day. And then when I come back to when I close down, like I'll get to the point where I'm like, okay, I feel like I'm not really adding anything more to the song, or like I'm playing through the song and trying to find what I need to do next. And you waste a lot of time doing that. So I feel like once I feel like I reach that point or I'm not sure what to do next, then I just close it down. Mm-hmm. And then I move on to the next. And then with the next song, it's you come in with fresher ears. And yeah. So I just like spreading things out like that.
That's a pretty awesome way to do stuff. I'm really like that style. I've been mixing some things recently, and I'm like, my reaction is when I'm like done working on something, I just, you know, close everything and go play a game or something.
That's right. Yeah, you just gotta walk away.
Yeah, yeah.
And one thing, like, and I did this a lot, but I think, at least in my opinion, like, you know, this is just for me. Development of a Void actually just asked a really good question. I'm gonna copy that and answer it later.
Love to hear that answer.
Yeah, that's actually a good one. I'll be revealing many of my secrets when I answer that. But so I don't export temporary mixes to listen to for myself, like when I'm working on something.
Okay.
Because of demo-itis. I want to avoid demo-itis. And I did this a lot. And so like you get, if you export like a song that's like 50% of the way done and listen to it, if you listen to it enough, you're just going to get used to it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's for better or for worse. And so when you when you come back to it and you want to add to it or change something, a lot of times you just kind of get used to what it sounded like,
right?
You know, then so I've stopped doing that for myself, and I only listen to the song when I'm working on it. So I encourage people to do that. Try to avoid the demo-itis.
Okay. I see. Now my side of that is I end up using exporting tracks to listen to in my car, because my car is, you know, where I'm driving around a lot, and good stereo and stuff. But you're totally right. I have exported songs. I have exported like Whip 3 versions of songs, and they've sat on my phone for like years, and I just listen to all the time.
Yeah.
And then I come back and I try to work on it. I'm like, the squeaky guitar is part of the song. I can't get rid of it.
Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah. It happens a lot, and everybody does it.
Yeah.
It's not the end of the world. It's not the end of the world. Sometimes like weird, quirky things kind of make a song. And so sometimes those accidental things have character. Right. But yeah, I try not to export something until like the whole thing is like arranged and written out. Sure. And then I've actually started working on the mix. And then once I have like full mix revision 1, that's when I'll export it and start listening on my headphones or in my car or whatever.
That's a very good way to do it. I'm gonna take that tip for myself.
Yeah, yeah. It takes a little bit of discipline, because you want to kind of like, especially if you're proud of something, you want to listen to it, right?
Yeah.
But it just takes a little self control.
As a musician who's been, you know, around the block for a long time doing a lot of producing and stuff, do you still get those kind of moments when you play something, you put together an arrangement, you orchestrate whatever it is, you mix it, and it's just like, oh my God, this sounds so good, and you just play it over and over? Do you still get that?
Yeah, for sure. You know, I try to make music that I want to listen to, for sure. Like, but I definitely, a lot of the music I listen to so many times that I don't want to listen to it anymore.
Especially
during the mixing process. Like the initial stages of just like, you know, from like the 40% to the, I'd say like the 80% mark, where it's like all arranged. It just needs to have the final mixing. That's, I think, like the part I like the most of making the song. But when I'm mixing,
still coming in, it hasn't gotten super old.
Yeah. And then, but by the time I've done like 1,000 passes of a song while mixing, then, and like by the time it's submitted to DoD, I'm like, I'm done with this song. I don't want to hear it anymore.
Yeah. No, I'm not talking about those kind of things. I'm talking about early on when you're, you know, you put together something that just sounds really, really good. And the first or second time hearing it, you're like, yeah, this is so good.
Yeah.
All right. So here's another good question. This isn't the really, really good one that we just saw, but this one's from Snappleman, and I would like to hear the answer to this. If you had to enter Dwelling of Duels against yourself, how would you approach winning? That might not be a kind of question that you want to answer, and that's okay.
I think... So, you know, it depends on, oh my God, I kind of hate talking about these things sometimes, because it just, I know I sound so full of myself when I'm talking about these things. I know people think that I'm like, I have a ginormous ego. You're probably not wrong.
We don't have to.
But like, I think if I've entered like a Tiberian Sun's track, it probably needs to be like an insane jazz track. Or vice versa,
mm-hmm.
essentially. Boy. Yeah. So like if I was up against a Tiberian Sun's version of me, like Connor had a good idea when, when we did the Ace Combat thing, where like he basically made like a Tiberian Sun's meme track, which is the Super Mario Odyssey mm-hmm. arrangement. And it definitely probably could, like it was very close to beating the Ace Combat one, and then the and Harmsing's track that month I think was oh, really yeah. close, and really, and it had it overcome the Ace Combat track, I think would have been like total, I wouldn't have been mad because it was great. Yeah, you know, I think it's like a good jazz track could probably overcome a Tiberian Sun's track for sure.
I think part of it is also like presenting something that has not been heard before in DoD.
Right. Yeah.
Like something that's never been heard before and done very well, I think can have a really good shot at getting first place and possibly dethroning the prince himself.
Right. Yeah. I wrote down a couple of the questions. Mm-hmm. Just answer those right now that I noticed. Early on, someone asked when I was going to remake Knights of Hyrule. Maybe at some point. I want to find. Yeah, I might do it. See if Travis is up for it. Development of a Void asked 5 magics ? When I was doing the Megadeth covers, when I was talking about early on in my recording process. No, 5 magics was not part of it. If I remember right, I did like 14 or 15 of them. Hangar 18, Prince of Darkness, which is where I get the name, Go to Hell. Let's see. I know Return to Hangar was in there too. Ashes in Your Mouth, Reckoning Day, Train of Consequences, Etoute Le Monde, Tornado of Souls. Oh boy. Hook and Mouth, Peace Cells. That's 11. I don't think Holy Wars was on it. Maybe it was. It probably would have been. But trust me, none of these sound that great.
Right. Everyone
no one's going to hear them. I'm just going to tell you I did them, and you can imagine what they probably sound like.
Yeah. Oh, man. It would have been awesome to. I would have loved to know somebody in high school who would have been doing those kind of things and been able to be, like, friends with them. And actually, that's funny. Did you have any, like, friends early on that you knew outside of like the internet that that you tried to like introduce to video game music or remixes or covers?
Yeah, for sure. So my buddy Travis Moberg, who he's the drummer in Tiberian Sons, like he and I have known each other since we were like 13 years old. And yeah, and so you know, I got him to sing on the Knights of Hyrule
track.
He's drummed on most of the Tiberian Sons stuff. But so I've gotten him and like in the past few years, he's made a push to become a video game composer himself. So, which is super cool. But I don't think, you know, he wasn't really doing that before Tiberian Sons. So after, you know, after we did the stuff with Frank Lopaki at MAGFest, it was, you know, kind of inspiring for all of us. So we've actually been working harder at doing all that. There are people like there are actually other internet acquaintances that I've gotten into DOD. So like Cursed Lemon was a guy that used to enter in DOD. Years ago, and he and I met him from the Megadeth forums. Nice. And yeah, and Connor, when I met Connor at TSO, I know Connor was into, you know, like video game music, but you know, like asking him and Travis to be part of the Spear and Sons kind of brought them into this community.
Mm-hmm. Nice. You had better luck than I did. I remember being in a punk band when I was like fresh out of high school and like showing people like a Diablo cover that I was working on, and they were just like,
"Yeah,
cool, okay." And, like, it just didn't go anywhere. I was like, "All
right, right,
I'll do this by myself." And that's when, you know, right, I learned how to play all the instruments myself so that I could do it.
Right.
Do you want to answer about secret band and albums you steal?
That's great. That's a great question. Okay. So yeah, is there a secret band / album you steal licks from? Not specifically licks. I think that just kind of like happens naturally from listening to like a lot of. I will say like Jeff Loomis from Nevermore influenced. Very heavily like how I approach like 7-string heavy riffs. Definitely Symphony X is a huge one for me. I would say Anubis Gate is a prog power metal band from Denmark, and I've definitely copied some shit from them. That's for sure. Anubis Gate's really, really, I like them a lot because they are not like they're considered like a progressive band, but they're not progressive in like, you know, the, you know, multiple time signatures vein of things. Like they're very melodic. They got great vocal harmonies and the mixing on Anubis Gate albums. I've always really loved. I'm sure I've probably stolen a lot of stuff from Devin Townsend because I really like Devin Townsend. I think a lot of the arrangements, especially arrangements, you know, like I've obviously done like a lot of the metal and symphonic stuff, but some of the other arrangements, maybe like some of the swing metal stuff or like the samba stuff, some of like the jazz fusion type stuff, like while I'm making those arrangements, I'll be listening to like an album or a few from particular artists that I'm just like, oh yeah, I should do something like that. So like when I'm making like Samba de Echidna from I don't know, like a year and a half ago or whenever, mm-hmm. I was listening to a lot of Michel Camillo, who is an unbelievable piano player from Cuba. And I was listening to a little bit of Gordon Goodwin. Gordon Goodwin is a big band arranger. And he has like this killing big band in LA. And their recordings are interesting because they don't sound like normal big band recordings. They are kind of more like modern produced. I would say, yeah, like when I'm doing jazz fusion, of course, it's like a lot of T-Square. or I really like Alex Argento and Marco Sfogli, who are these like Italian like metal fusion players. Ooh, okay. they play with like a lot of metal musicians, but they do like fusion stuff on their on their own.
Now, when you're talking about like obviously we're not actually stealing entire songs,
right?
Like,
right.
What kind of things do you listen to? Do you listen to like the way that they're playing things, certain licks that they do on different types of instruments, or are you talking more of like a production like back?
It's kind of more like a compositional sort of thing. Like what instruments are being used
for sure
at a particular time, like or. I'm always kind of like listening on like especially like drum beats, like with like a lot of jazz stuff, it's really easy to just like make it sound like even when you're programming, it's pretty easy to make it sound like a rock drummer trying to play jazz if all you've done is program rock drums. So listening to like a lot of like legit jazz players, you know, play like a samba beat or a sango or there's a lot of words I can't pull them up but it's just like listening to those and trying to recreate those to make it sound as like authentic as possible,
right? The grooves,
considering the circumstances, right?
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, I think everybody's can name at least a couple licks or drum fills or things that have definitely been stolen by other albums from other projects. Totally. And things.
And of course, Dream Theater is the big one. Specifically the Glass Prison, like the Glass Prison and like Nevermore. Like basically that's how I play seven string guitar. That's how I construct all my riffs. That's all you need to know. And like Symphony X, I draw a lot of the orchestral stuff from, because that's, you know, I've been listening to Symphony X for a really long time. Mm-hmm. And the way like Michael Romeo orchestrates everything, I take a lot from that.
That's awesome. Speaking of the orchestral style, we were talking earlier, you mentioned doing like trailer music and stuff like that. And you know, a lot of your Tiberian Sun stuff has that kind of symphonic metal sound to a big, huge production sound. What is it about that sound that has like, that keeps you coming back to it, but coming back for more?
Yeah, I've always kind of, I would actually say it's not even just that. It's, I have always gravitated towards big ensembles for some reason. Like, even in high school, I preferred doing big band over doing like jazz combo, you know, like bass, piano, drums. Now I like all that and I like all ensembles, but like there was always something about like the idea of an orchestra, and not in just the traditional sense, but the idea of like a fuck ton of musicians all playing together and it making a wall of sound, more or less. That's one of the reasons why I like big band so much, is it's like all of these musicians that have to work together, they have to cooperate, and they have to like put their egos aside. I guess that means I get to be the one with a giant ego when I'm directing all the musicians. But yeah, I would say actually one of the a couple of the game changer songs for me for like metal and orchestra, I would actually name three. Christmas Eve Sarajevo by Trans-Siberian Orchestra. That was definitely the first one I heard, and I was like, whoa, that's crazy. Like, it's a rock band, but it sounds symphonic. I would say Progenies of the Great Apocalypse by Dimmu Borgir.
That's a great one.
Because I think I was 15 when I heard that one. And then I would actually say the Advent Children version of One Winged Angel. That was huge for me. That one was massive for me. When I heard that, I was like, holy crap.
Was that one arranged by Uematsu, or was that someone else?
No, that was it was two of the other guys who were in the Black Mages. It was like one of the guitar players and the keyboard player, I think, or did that version. So it's like, yeah, the guitar player, I don't remember their names. One of the guitar players is kind of more of a jazz fusion guy. Like, they had the second guitar player who's more of a shred guy, but I think it was like the more like jazz fusion dude that did it and did all the guitars on that. And then the keyboard player, because Uematsu always loves to play organ, so yeah. It was like the other keyboard player who did like the keys and the drums actually.
Okay.
I think on that arrangement. Yeah, but that was a big deal for me when I heard that one.
We should get Tony. We should rally around and petition to get you to arrange tracks for another Earthbound Papa's album, because that would be
great. That'd be great. I played the fretless bass on the second one. And that was a blast.
You got to do a bunch of stuff. All right, so we are gonna take a little short little break here and listen to some tunes from Tony himself.
Original tracks.
Yes, these are all original non-VGM tracks. Do you want to give us like a little introduction to these three that we're listening to?
Sure. Do you know what order you're gonna play them in?
Whatever order you name them, I'll play them in.
Okay. How about this? So let's do. So there's an original Tiberian Sons track. We'll do that one first. Called Permafrost, that I wrote and we got in Soundfall, a new rhythm game that was released, which our old DOD artwork did so much artwork. Nate Horsfall did a lot of the animation and stuff for that game. He did a whole bunch of stuff for that game.
So much.
And then there's a song I wrote for Soto, which is with Jeff Scott Soto on lead vocals. It's very Tony. It's very Tony. It'll make sense. And then a Silva song for a little bit of a different flavor, which is kind of like a dance funk thing, which got Travis on vocals, Travis Moberg on vocals.
Awesome. Well, let's go ahead and kick things off here with some Tiberian Sons, Permafrost. Keep it here, everybody. This is Dwelling of Duels. We'll be right back. And welcome back, everybody. We just heard a very good smattering of tracks written and collaborated on by Tony Dickinson here. Let's recap as we are wont to do around here. First, we heard that Tiberian Sons track, Permafrost. Mm-hmm. Frank Klebacki and the Tiberian Sons from Soundfall.
That was not Frank.
Frank's not
that one. Was not Frank. That we do have Frank Klepacki and the Tiberian Sons tracks that are on Soundfall as well.
Okay.
But those are different. The Permafrost was a fully Tiberian Sons original. I wrote that. Max played bass, Travis on drums, Connor doing a guitar solo halfway through. We have plans for more original Tiberian Sons stuff too.
Where does that show up in the game?
Oh, it's the ice biome. It might be, if it's not the last, it's one of the last.
Gotcha.
I believe.
Gotcha. Then we heard Afterglow by Soto, Jeff Scott Soto's band. That was a fantastic one. And yeah, that breakdown was 100% Tony. You could hear all the influences in there. So good. So mathy. And then we just heard from Silva, something we found. Tell us a little bit about Silva.
Silva was, Travis and I started it shortly after, I think, graduating high school, where like we had like a metal band in high school, but we're like, you know, we like all this like funky and pop stuff too. Why don't we just, you know, form a band like that? And so we did that. Throughout college, we didn't really do a whole lot with Silva. Like I would write maybe a Silva track every 6 months or something. But we had finally put something together roughly about 2015 with like an actual band, and we recorded this album in 2018. And that was basically like everything I'd written up to, from like 2008 through 2018. Unfortunately, we don't really have any plans for Silva at the moment. Travis has twins, he's a firefighter, his time's very limited. And we're actually making more money as the Tiberian Sons than we ever did with Silva. So we're just kind of like focusing on that right now.
Yeah.
I love the Silva kind of music. And even if like Silva doesn't do anything, I'm still going to be making like my own, Silva type music on my own. It will happen. It will happen. But I'm trying to keep focused on like one or two projects at a time.
You can't be one of the major problems that I suffer from myself is always like starting new projects without finishing old ones or
right.
Yeah. Like that. So working on Soundfall,
mm-hmm.
You know, this is pretty awesome. This officially makes you a game composer, right?
Yeah.
That must have been a pretty awesome feeling to get to work on that. So were you writing songs? You wrote Permafrost yourself, mm-hmm. as you just said. And then you said you had two more songs that you did with Frank Klepacki.
Yes. So Frank, a couple years ago, or like a few months into quarantine, Frank was like, "Hey, Tony. So I got like all these like leftover riffs and stuff that I've just been laying around. Do you want to do something with it? And we can like release it as like a Frank Klepacki and the Tiberian Sons like original release." So we actually have four songs. We are getting close to releasing that EP. Two of those are in Soundfall. So it's basically like Frank Klepacki riffs that are put through the Tiberian Sons like insano filter. We do have so Frank would just give us like these riffs. It's like riffs and drums. And then we rearranged it. Connor and Travis actually also helped arrange Skywar on that EP. I arranged the other three and did a little bit on Skywar. And Frank would kind of come back in and put some extra elements on things as we were working on it. That EP, we are very excited because we love the songs on it. It should be coming out very soon. You can actually pre-order it right now. I should try to find a link. Or actually, since I see Nate and Max in the chat, they should find the link and put it in if you guys want to pre-order. We actually putting out merchandise for this EP release. We're pretty stoked about it.
Very cool.
But it should be coming out very, very soon.
Yeah. For those of you who don't know out there, Frank Lopacki was the original composer for the Command & Conquer series, Command & Conquer Red Alert as well. Westwood Studios fame. Wonderful stuff. And Frank Lopacki and the Tiberian Sons played at MAGFest a few years ago. One of the best shows I've ever seen at MAGFest. Second only maybe to Uematsu playing with the Earthbound Papas, because that was just
how can you amazing show.
Musically, that was an amazing show, but I gotta say, visually, the Frank Lopacki show was insane and so good. but yeah, just the music that you guys have put out, and you all did the remastered soundtrack that came out last year.
No, 2020. It was 2020. I think it was June 2020, actually.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, when the remaster came out.
Again, yep. Time.
I know, right?
Yes, but great stuff. Frank Lopacki's, writing is amazing, and getting to see it, as you said, put through the Insano filter is fantastic stuff. Mm-hmm. Was there any more questions in the chat that we had picked
up? I had a couple written down. I will answer these. If you guys have any more, please write them in. So I think it was Jet Swole maybe asked, what's your composition process from start to finish? How much are you transcribing or recording scratch guitar, or do you just retain the song sketch in your head? I don't keep a whole lot in my head. I mean, I kind of start doing that. The remixing and composition processes are a little they start different, but like then they kind of converge and the same shit happens. But so like when I'm doing a remix, what I've done, and I started kind of doing this with the Shantae remix a few years ago, where it's like this shit is really complicated. I've discovered I don't like if I'm working on something, having to go and like transcribe what's happening and then go back and then remix and then transcribe and then remix and then transcribe. It feels like too much of a gear shift for me. So what I started doing was, if I'm going to remix something, I'm going to transcribe the entire thing first. And I'm going to keep like all the information in the MIDI regions. And then when I'm remixing, I can take that MIDI region and I can place it somewhere. I can just copy and paste it on an instrument. I'll write out like a chord chart and stuff like that. And so it'll just be kind of easier to follow along. And that keeps me in a certain frame of mind that keeps the creative juices flowing.
Yeah. process, right?
Yeah. And then so composing it, like it takes me a really long time to feel like get the initial idea of a song, because I'm super particular about making sure it something what I'm doing is good. And but once I find that initial idea, then I almost switch to the arrangement mind, where it's like, okay, if I have the idea, then it's just the same shit. Like it's as if somebody else wrote that
the melody, and you're just like, now let's fuck the melody up the way I normally do.
Yeah, so it's not really any different than DOD. If once you get that idea down, it's the initial idea, I think, is the most difficult part. One that's like really good, that really stands out, and the one that I'm happy with, one that I can sit with.
I think that's a really awesome thing once you realize that kind of skill. If you've been spending a lot of time doing covers and remixes and arranging melodies that already exist, figuring out that, like, having that switch in your head flip of like, wait, I can just do that to this like 8-note melody that I wrote, and like it's the same thing that I'm used to doing, but it's new music. That is such a light bulb moment, I think, that
totally.
I think people can realize out there.
Yeah. And I have, I guess you can argue that I have way more experience arranging than I do on the original stuff. So once you start harnessing that power, then it's like, oh, actually it's the same shit.
It's the same thing. Slightly different, but yeah, same thing.
And they also asked about recording scratch guitar. So especially when I'm arranging, I definitely do a lot of scratch guitar on something. But now, like, since I've been doing like session guitar work for like at least about 10 years now, I've gotten to the point where I end up keeping a lot of the scratch stuff. But I can easily be careless, you know, if I'm just like, I just got to get it down, I just want to get through it, then that needs to be replaced later. But like over time, I'm keeping more of the scratch stuff just because I think I've gotten a lot of practice at putting things. Well, there's that, yes. But just technique consistency, making it, you know, good pocket and stuff like that. It's all practice.
Mm-hmm.
Any bucket list tracks you've always wanted to do but haven't yet? Any tracks you love but don't go near out of some kind of reverence? Man, I would want to do One Winged Angel, but I feel like it's kind of been done, you know? Like, I love it dearly, but it's like, who needs another One Winged Angel?
Yeah, you'll never beat Danimal Cannon's original One Winged Angel that got like last place.
Any bucket list tracks? There's a lot of, because I'm such a Sonic nerd, there's a lot of Sonic stuff I want to do.
I feel like this is a great question, but I feel like as a Dwelling of Duels person, everybody has their like secret list of songs that they want to do, but like
we'll
reveal because it's like I'm waiting for the day to do it.
So I won't go into any specifics, but
is there any track though, continuing on Roth's question, is there any track that you feel like you couldn't make it better or couldn't change it in any way to that would be adding value?
One Winged Angel. But that's how I felt for Daredevil, where it was like, well, like when I did, for Ace Combat 7, I was like, this is just such a fucking good song. Like, I can just put drums and guitars on top of it and make it the same song, and it just kind of feels like a waste of time because it's just so good. Mm-hmm. So I think what I like to do, if I feel like I can't add too much to a song, is I'll medley them together. Sure. So like on the Paper Mario Origami stuff or Origami King stuff, like the one I did for like MAGFest DOD this past January or whatever.
Yeah.
That's a medley of three songs. But like if you listen to the original songs, they're like three quarters of the way to being Tiberian Sun's songs to begin with, just like the ensemble. It's like it's clear that those composers were like prog heads. So instead of just doing like straight covers of that, like I put a few of them together, so at least it's something new, you know. I would change up some of like the riffs and stuff, but they're like, I will admit that like a lot of that stuff is pretty close to like how a Tiberian Sun song would end up.
That's so crazy to hear that the Paper Mario Origami King soundtrack would be the most Tiberian Sun's like music.
I love it so dearly. I love it so much. It feels like they wrote it just for me. Like it's,
yeah.
Oh, I love it. Have you ever considered writing or releasing an album's worth of original music on your own time? Yes, I have. The Silva stuff is obviously that. We're on Spotify. This summer I definitely plan on writing a lot more original stuff. I think my original music brain kind of gets tapped out when I've been doing a lot of library music. I've been doing a little bit less library music this year just because of like budgets with the companies that I work with and everything. But I am most certainly planning on writing more original music. That'll be kind of my major focus this summer, including like original Tiberian Sun's music and original other types of music. So
awesome.
Yeah.
That's so exciting. How many, when you're writing library music, like how much stuff are you putting out with them
before 2019, it was a sweet gig because I was doing several albums a year and they were just like throwing money everywhere. And then, so this is with Warner Chappell, and then but I think what was happening was that they were making all these albums, but not releasing them. They were just kind of sitting once they were done. They would spend all this money on like getting live orchestras and everything. And like I attended some of these orchestra sessions for the stuff that I wrote, and then they just wouldn't upload them so that they could make money on them. And so I think what happened is that the executives kind of got pissed and they restructured the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And they kind of pushed out the guys who I was working directly for. So I've still been doing some of that stuff, but I've been doing it directly for like the guys who I was working for. So like they have like their own companies, but they don't have Warner Chappell budget anymore. They have right. like their own personal budgets. So it's kind of gone down. It's been like a, you know, instead of, besides like four or five projects a year, it's been more like two.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of a bummer, but so that's why it's like, well, you know, maybe I'm just gonna be kind of working on video games,
some video game stuff. So, and so like these library music is stuff that they would use for like commercials and like mm-hmm. and TV and things like that.
Yeah, and I've done like, and library music is interesting because like I've done all sorts of genres for it. I'm not even particularly proud of most of it. It's just like. I've done hip hop. I've done electronic music. I mean, I've done I tend to get hired as the rock guy, but I started doing like a lot of electronic stuff. But it's just one of those things where it's like you're writing for you're functionally writing as opposed to like artistically writing. You know,
sure.
You're just like writing for another person's purpose for mm-hmm. like a commercial. You know. So like there's not a lot of passion that kind of goes into it, you know, but there's a good amount of money if you are trying to appease the masses for better yeah. or worse. It's just, you know, like, but I can't have library music be the only thing I do, you right. know? So that's why that's why I found myself coming back, always, you know, coming back to like remixes and Silva, like even if that stuff isn't making me like, you know, much money, I still love doing it because it's like it's me, like me, the truest form of me probably won't be able to make a lot of money because he does insane things.
I think that's for the nerds. Problem for all of us.
Yeah
Well, I have one last question for you, Tony, before
okay.
we all
okay.
here. And this is the tough one that I ask mm-hmm. everybody. What's the top bit of advice that you would give to anybody out there entering DoD, whether they're a newbie or a seasoned vet? What's like, what's just your number one tip that you want to bestow on people?
So
it's a doozy. You can mellow on it for a second.
Yeah. You know, I would say be versatile. Try to be versatile. Like we were talking earlier, is that you get a better perspective on things you know when you try to do things you don't know. I think it's honestly good general musical advice to try to learn as much as you can, even if it's like obviously like no human's going to be able to play every instrument, but if you learn how to write for other instruments, if you try to pick up a secondary instrument and then like play in a band where somebody else is, you know, holding down your primary instrument, that definitely gives you some big perspective. You know, like when I've been like being a guitar player playing with other bass players, I definitely got a better idea on what people are expecting out of a bass player. I would say develop good relative pitch if you don't have it, because that is one of the best things a musician can do for themselves. Good relative pitch is amazing. It's so useful. Anybody can develop it. People with perfect pitch are born with it. And you can't really develop it. Relative pitch allows you to kind of like take in information about music by just listening to it. So when you can like identify the scales and the chord progressions and everything, you can just kind of pay more attention to music and get something out of it by just listening to it. And I think that's one of the things I always like try to teach like my students, is try to get them on relative pitch. Relative pitch also helps you develop like your inner ear, where like good improvisers have a good inner ear, and that comes with good relative pitch training. But like good improvisers can basically they can like predict where they're going before they go there, versus like versus letting their fingers dictate where they're going, right? So there is, you know, like if people who are out there who are trying to become like better, like soloists with instruments, I don't think I'm like that great of a soloist. I just haven't spent a whole heck of a lot of time working on improvisation, but definitely the difference between good improvisers and like all right improvisers is like a lot of the okay improvisers is they have chops but they kind of let their muscle memory dictate where they're going, whereas the great improvisers they kind of treat it like they're a singer, like the phrasing, and their ear leads them where they're gonna go.
They hear the melody and they express it to their instrument rather than.
Yeah. So like it happens up here and then it comes out through these. Of course, you do have to have good muscle memory in order to pull some of those things off. So of course you still have to, you know, practice a lot of the fundamentals and everything. That's the whole point of scales and arpeggios and everything. It's just like the fingers need to know where to go, but it needs to happen up here. It should not happen here. That's why it's like, you know, sometimes it's like hearing a guitar player just play all their favorite licks can be boring because, you know, it doesn't always say something, you know,
right, when you're just so lick after lick together.
Yeah. So versatility, relative pitch, just learn everything, learn production, learn how to transcribe, learn how to write charts. Nothing can hurt you by trying to learn it. Now, of course, like I'm a professional musician and I have all hours of the day to do this. So like a lot of DOD people are hobbyists and they're just doing it for fun. And that's totally great. That's awesome. And like you guys can't focus on all the things at once. You know, like people got kids, people got jobs, they're doing this for fun. So some of my advice, you know, doesn't really apply. And at the end of the day, You guys should just be doing this for fun. I don't always do it for fun because I'm a perfectionist and I'm always trying to beat myself at the very least. At the end of the day, music is fun.
Yeah,
and we should be doing it because we love it. And doing it with a community like DOD is the best way to do it.
Yeah, I think, even just like dipping your foot a little bit into those different aspects of music that you talked about, like, you know, spending one, like if you only do music 1 hour a week, you know, maybe one of those hours you learn how to use a compressor or something like that. And just that one little hour will help you so much.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, yeah. Let me piggyback on that is consistency is the best thing you can do. So like, I had said earlier in this where like I wasn't always the best like exercise player, but during quarantine, you know, I was like, well, I have all this time on my hands, I'm going to try to be a very consistent, like, you know, do things every day player. See what happens. See what I can accomplish, even if I'm just doing like 15 minutes a day of something. So, sorry, I'm burpy because I am drinking a Cayman Jack margarita. It's very delicious.
Very nice. Plug.
But so one of the first things I did during quarantine was, well, I was working on God Shattering Star, which we did a couple years ago. There's so many great piano parts in that song, and I wanted to learn them. And I was like, well, you know, I have some piano experience. My mom was a piano teacher. But I don't consider myself like a virtuoso by any means. I can play some basic stuff, and if I practice it, I can play it. But like God Shattering Star had all these insane great keyboard parts that I want to learn how to play. But I was like, well, I'm just gonna start at like 15% tempo and see where I can go. And so I started with just like one 8-measure phrase, and I just worked on it like 20 minutes a day for about 3 weeks. And I got from about 15% to at least about 80% tempo of playing of playing that part by just doing it like 20 minutes a day.
Yeah.
So like there, like I realize that people, you know, they have lives, they have kids, they have jobs and everything. But, and like me, I'm trying to do like all these things. I've got projects to work on, and there are like a lot of things that I want to do. I don't really want to practice for like 3 hours a day, but there's a lot that you can get accomplished if you're just like, you can, if you're just focusing on one or two things and you're doing them every day, like there, as long as you're doing it correctly when you begin with, which you might need a teacher to just kind of like tell you whether or not you're doing it right or not. But if you're just doing it, if you're doing it correctly, like I don't think there's anything you can't learn as long as you just start at like a slow enough tempo and you just build it. And you just build up the tempo. Now, of course, there are some like, there are some asterisks, like there are certain things with certain instruments where you physically do it differently at a higher speed, like guitar. Guitar, you use different sets of muscles once you start playing fast. Again, consult a guitar teacher for that. But yeah, like we all have 20 minutes a day that we could be doing something. So like if it's just, if you're just working on an arpeggio, you're going to be a master of an arpeggio after 2 weeks.
Yeah.
You're doing it every day.
Yeah. And finding that 20 minutes, you know, people are always like, oh man, I can't even spare 20 minutes a day.
It's like,
put your guitar next to your bed and do it in the morning.
How much time are you wasting on this thing?
There you go.
Like, there's plenty of time. Whatever time you're spending on this thing, divide it in half and put it on an instrument.
Yeah. I had to dig out a journal of mine because I found a quote a while ago that's very relevant to this that I wanted to share because it's so good. Establishing and keeping a routine can be even more important than having a lot of time. If you have all the time in the world, it doesn't matter unless you're routinely doing this thing that you're working on. You know, yeah. The routine is what really, really can make things work. You know, I had so much time in 2020 with quarantine stuff that I mean, you know, it was a mess. Everything got kind of jumbled up. But like, I think about all the hours that went by there that I like didn't do anything because I did not have a routine. I was just like, well, it's 4 p.m. and I'm waking up now.
Right.
But if I have also, a routine, then
yeah,
things
will. I'll also say one thing I've kind of been thinking about a lot lately is that the way most people view motivation is kind of an illusion. Motivation happens, like people think that motivation is the first thing that needs to happen before you do something. Like you need to be motivated to do it. But it's actually, you got like a lot of times you got to do the thing first. Like you have to take an action to get the ball rolling. Mm-hmm. And then once the ball starts rolling and like you're getting, and you get used to it and you're getting a little success with it, then that creates the motivation.
Exactly.
And then the motivation creates more momentum.
Yeah.
So it's like the process, I think, is momentum, motivation, momentum. So, but the first thing has to be momentum. So, and that's again, and that ties into consistency. It's like, I don't necessarily want to do like scales or anything, like they're super boring, but you gotta start doing it first. And I might distract, like a lot of times if I'm just doing like, you know, endurance stuff or just things doing, like I'll distract myself with Netflix. I will not do the thing, you know, if it's just like a physical thing, I will not do the thing consistently if I'm not, like I'll get bored really, really easy. But
by the 10-minute rule of being like, all right, I'm gonna do this thing for 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And right. after 10 minutes, if I'm like not feeling it, I'll stop and come back tomorrow and do it again.
For
but
sure.
Most of the time, 75%
of the time, you're gonna keep going.
I'm like, okay, I'm in the mood, let's go.
Yeah, because it's the momentum.
Exactly.
Momentum has to happen first.
Mm-hmm.
So like, man, I never feel like going to the gym. I don't. I've never felt like a gym rat. But like I make myself go because I sit in this stupid office chair for 10 hours a day and my body hurts when I haven't been going to the gym. So I just have to force myself to go. And then once I get there, it's like, okay, I feel good. My body's feeling better. I've been moving. But yeah, so cap it off. Versatility.
Yeah.
Learn everything. Momentum happens before motivation. Relative pitch
and get good
Get good. You're good. All those things will make you get good.
Yes, exactly. And then, I was going to mention earlier, Tony, there has been some serious contenders to take over your first place streak going on with DOD.
And that's true, man. There's some real good talent lately.
Yeah.
Real good talent.
It's a bit harder to maintain your first place landslide victories these days. So
it's tough. There are definitely people nipping at my heels. People that worry me, that's for sure.
Oh, everybody, watch out! Tony's gonna learn some new instruments. You got to learn harp next. That's the way you can solidify first place. Well, Tony, thanks so much for hopping on and chatting with us this evening. It's been super wonderful. I love talking to you anytime, and I'm sure everybody in the chat here.
You too.
Oh, thanks. Thanks everybody in the chat for hanging out. We have a few more events happening this month. We're doing our monthly Discord hangout on Monday evening. We're going on gather.io, I think is what it is, gather.io, where we're just going to hang out and chat and keep up with people. If anyone out there wants to join, all that stuff is in our Discord server there. And this month's theme is Fresh Month for Dwelling of Duels. And that means that any song is valid and acceptable as long as it has not been covered, as long as the game it's from has not been covered on DOD before. So no Chrono Triggers, no Final Fantasy VIIs, no Super Mario Worlds. But Mario Teaches Typing? That could work. Stuff like that.
Yeah.
Big thanks to all of our subscribers that subscribed earlier on in the stream. Retro Reboot, Hat, and Max Noel. Thanks a bunch. We're also on Patreon at patreon.com/dwellingofduels if you want to join our special supporters-only channel, where Tony is a member of that channel only because he's an admin in the Discord. and yes, please join our Discord server as well, where you can chat with myself, Tony, and all of the other wonderful competitors of Dwelling of Duels all month long. And until next time, I'm Katagen, and that's Prince of Darkness, Tony Dickinson. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in, and enjoy the rest of your evening.